Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. Today we are continuing our study on the names of God. Today's reading is from 2 Kings 6, 15 to 17. Hear now, this is the word of the Lord. When the servant of the man of God got up and went out early the next morning, an army with horses and chariots had surrounded the city. "Oh no, my lord, what shall we do?" the servant asked. "Don't be afraid," the prophet answered. "Those who are with us are more than those who are with them." And Elisha prayed, "Open his eyes, Lord, so that he may see." Then the Lord opened the servant's eyes, and he looked and saw the hills full of horses and chariots of fire all around Elisha. Let's pray. Lord God, we are thankful that even when we cannot see you, you are nearer than we imagine. Thank you that you are for us, that you are behind us, you are with us. We ask that today, as we study your word, you would speak to us and reveal yourself just a little more clearly through your word. In your name we pray, amen. So today's sermon title is Yahweh of Hosts, or Lord of Angel Armies. And I wanted to start the topic asking a question: can God? Now, I ask this question because often we question God's power. There's an atheist website that used to be up called Chariots of Iron. They base it on a verse in Judges that talk about how the Israelites weren't able to drive out certain people. They were too strong for them because they had chariots of iron. And they say, see, God wasn't able. Here's a verse in your own scriptures that prove it. The teenagers I work with ask me all the time, why doesn't God act? Why did he allow the Holocaust to happen? Why doesn't God put evil to an end once and for all, or let evil in the world in the first place? And then I think all of us ask, why is there disease and suffering? Why do good people die young? Why doesn't God heal me? Can God? Then you have this story. You have Elisha. Now, he was a student of Elijah. But when Elijah knew he was going to die, Elisha asked him for a double portion of his spirit. Elijah said, that's a pretty big request. But if you see me leaving, then that's a sign that God has granted it to you. And chariots again. You see Elijah leaving and chariots and horses of fire. Elisha sees it. And God grants him what he asked for. Now, this is a strange story about Elisha. He hears what the king says in secret in his bedroom. The kids were telling me he's a rather creepy prophet. He's definitely, it's odd. It's an odd story. The king of Aram, he keeps setting out to attack the king of Israel. But every time he sends his troops, the king of Israel finds out and isn't there. And he doesn't get ambushed, and he doesn't get attacked over and over again. And the king of Aram is like, "Where do we have a traitor? What is going on?" And they said, no. The prophet Elisha knows what you were saying in secret, and he reveals it to the king. And he's not like eavesdropping at the door. He's in a different city. This man, this prophet, is more dangerous than the king of Israel. And so the Arameans set out to capture Elisha. They surround the city he's in at night. His servant sees them and is afraid. But surely he must have seen God work in the past, or at least heard stories. To recap, for those of you who don't have Elisha's resume memorized, here's a few of the things that he did up until this point. He cured bad water. It was poisonous, and so he put salt in it, and it never became bad again. Then there's some people mocking him, and he calls for bears to come out of the woods, and you can guess where that one goes. There's a widow who is afraid that because of her debts, her sons are going to be sold into slavery. And so he is the one who introduces this miracle of oil that doesn't run out, and they keep pouring it into pan after pan and selling it, and she's able to pay off her debts. You have a barren woman who wants a son so badly, and Elisha prays for her, and she has a son, but then later the son dies, and Elisha prays, and he comes back to life. Then there's poisonous food, and after the people have already eaten it, he cures it, and no one dies. There are 20 loaves of bread that feed 100 people with leftovers. Are you starting to hear some similarities here? Then there's the most famous story that we learn in Sunday school as a kid. Naaman is cured of leprosy. His servant girl tells him, hey, there's a prophet in Israel who could heal you. And so he goes to Israel, and Elisha says, okay, go and dip in the Jordan 7 times. And the man, Naaman, doesn't want to do it. He's like, every body of water is cleaner than the Jordan River. Why would I do that? But he does it, and he's healed. Fun fact, Naaman was actually the army commander for the king of Aram. Go figure. And then the last event that we hear about in Elisha's life before this one, he's with a bunch of other prophets, and they're chopping down trees to make a shelter. And one of the men, his axe head, which is heavy, it's probably iron, it slips and falls into the river. And he's freaking out because he borrowed it. Now he's going to owe a debt to someone. And Elisha makes the axe head float. This obviously is not his activity. It is God working through him. But it is very evident through the prophet Elisha's life that God is powerful, that God is working, that God is doing amazing, miraculous things through this prophet. And yet, Elisha's servant sees the army. And it changes things a little when you're the one surrounded. It's wonderful to hear all these stories of how great God is. But they must have seemed maybe almost like fairy tales in comparison to an army that's now staring him in the face. The servant knew that God could act, but now his life is at stake. And the armies of Israel, who might be able to defend them from the armies of Aram, are with the king, not with Elisha. Can God? I want to pause in this story for just a moment and switch over to this name for God, Yahweh Tzavaot, the Lord of hosts. I want to pronounce that word for you, tzava, because often when we see it spelled out, it looks like Sabaoth, like Lord of the Sabbath, but that's actually a different word, that's Shabbat. And so that's why I'm giving you my butchered Hebrew translation just to demonstrate the difference. Tzavaot, it's actually a word that's used for army, tzava, so that the IDF, the Israeli Defense Force, the full name in Hebrew is Tzava HaHaganah LeYisrael. Please don't replay that for an actual Hebrew speaker. The idea behind that, or what that phrase literally means, is the army for the defense of Israel. So this word, it's modern times it's used as well to mean army. But here's the thing, when it's God that is being talked about, it has a couple of other meanings. First, it could mean an army of angels, the host of heaven. They don't just sing. I know we think, okay, the angels come and they sing a song and they make announcements, but they're also able to fight. And we have examples in scripture where they're at war on behalf of God's people, on behalf of justice. Then in Deuteronomy 4:19, and I'm giving you the verse because it's cool and you might want to look it up, Moses is talking to the people and reminding them, lest you see the sun, the moon, and the stars, the host of heaven, and he uses that word again, lest you see them and worship them, don't do it. They are created things. And then in Genesis 2:1, host is used to describe all of creation. And this is the first time this word, tzava, is used in the Bible. Don't mistake any of the creation for the creator. And don't limit your understanding of God to that of a warrior. He is more than the God of armies, the Lord of hosts. Can God? Not only does God have the power, God has all of creation at his disposal. Yes, God absolutely can. But then back to the story. Elisha could have said to his servant when he says, what do we do? He could have said, what can hinder the Lord from saving, whether by many or by few? If you remember, these are the words that Jonathan spoke to his sidekick when the two of them single-handedly caused a lot of havoc on one of the Philistine armies. God absolutely could use two people, but he doesn't. Instead, he prays and he says, Lord, open his eyes. And then the story gets even more interesting because this entire sermon, I've been saying God can. And in this case, God didn't. God showed where he was, where his armies were. There's armies of angels, chariots, and horses of fire. I don't know if they were on the ground right between them or maybe they were up above, but they were close. They were between Elisha and his servant and the enemy. They were ready to act. It reminds me of the pillar of fire and the pillar of cloud that God sent when his people were in the wilderness, escaping from Egypt. And he put this pillar of fire between them and their enemies. This is similar. You have chariots and horses of fire between them and their enemies. Can God? Yes, but God didn't. They're there. They're waiting to act. And Elisha prays that God would send blindness over all of the enemy troops. And God does. And then it gets even more entertaining. Elisha goes down and they must not have known his voice. And he said, oh, you took the wrong road and you're at the wrong city, but let me guide you to where you're going. And they follow him. And he leads them directly to Samaria, takes them inside the walled city. And then he prays, Lord, open their eyes. And they see where they are and they are trapped. They trusted the wrong man. And the king of Israel is like, great, what should we do? Should we kill them all? And Elisha says, nah, feed them and send them on their way. So the enemy army is fed and leaves. And you could say this is a great victory for the people of God because after Naaman's experience and after this army's experience, the king of Aram is going to say, oh, the Israelites, they're wonderful, hospitable people. Their God is so gracious. Let's never attack them again. That's kind of how this story ends until the next verse when it says that the king sent his men to attack Israel again. Often in our lives, we see God's in action. And I want to challenge you not to mistake God's compassion for weakness. God absolutely can act. We love verses that say God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world. Or God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son, that whoever believes in him will not perish, but have everlasting life. And yet we also know that one day God has promised to return, to come to this world and rid it of all the evil. One day he will put an end to all injustice. And God always keeps his promises. So in your own life, when you're struggling, wondering, why doesn't God act? Can he? Know that not only, yes, he can, but he promises that he will. Let's pray. Lord God, we are thankful that you're a promise-keeping God. And we are thankful that you care about our lives, about your people. We ask that we would look for you, that we would see how you are at work around us, how you are near us, how you are for us. And we ask that we would follow you wherever you lead us, trusting that you will never leave us. In your name we pray, amen.
You hear me when I call, you are my morning song. Though darkness fills the night, it cannot hide the light. Whom shall I fear? You crush the enemy underneath my feet. You are my sword and shield. Though troubles linger still, whom shall I fear? I know who goes before me.
Of a time when I was in Israel. And we were in Jerusalem, and the director of my school was explaining how Jerusalem is kind of located in a bowl. There's hills all around it. Now, it's not like they're tall hills, but it's enough hills that were the enemy armies to come marching up, they could surround the city, and there would be no way to escape, no way for anyone else to come and fight for us. And so with that location in mind, and possibly even that scenario in mind, David writes, "I lift my eyes to the hills. Where does my help come from? It comes from the Lord, the creator of heaven and earth." And the director told us that, you know, you can look to the hills and panic because your help isn't coming. But you shouldn't stop there. You should look a little bit higher than the hills. Look to the one who made the hills, because he has promised to come to our aid. God bless you.
I know who goes before me. I know who stands before me.